Thank you so much for joining us for CBN NewsWatch. I'm Ephraim Graham.
And I'm Charlene Aaron. Well, its terror has spread from Syria and Iraq to Libya and other parts of Africa. While the terror group ISIS is involved in tough battles in Iraq and Syria, their ideology and radical Islam is gaining influence around the world, including right here in America.
The U.S. and coalition forces continue to bombard ISIS militants in Iraq and Syria, taking out major targets of the terrorist group. ISIS has lost the key city of Tikrit in Iraq, and Iraqi security have made some gains against ISIS in Ramadi. The key is holding those territories. CBN News terrorism analyst Eric Stackelbeck says the U.S. and other world leaders aren't willing to do what it takes to really attack ISIS.
The will is not there. ISIS is not some 800-pound gorilla. Yes, they have some 30 to 40,000 foot soldiers, if not more, in the heart of the Middle East. They control some 35,000 square miles of territory. Yes, they're a formidable force in the Middle East. But they're no match for the might of the United States military or European nations.
But despite the tough battles in Iraq with wins and losses, the influence of ISIS and radical Islam is still scoring victories around the world by making new converts. Here in the U.S., there have been several cases just in the last week. Four of the six men from Minnesota accused of trying to join ISIS have been ordered to stay in jail until their trial. The other two defendants will appear in a California court. U.S. Attorney Andrew Lugar says they had been making their plans for 10 months.
To be clear, we have a terror recruiting problem in Minnesota. And this case demonstrates how difficult it is to put an end to recruiting here. These are focused men who are intent on joining a terrorist organization by any means possible.
And a 20-year-old woman from Alabama left her family to join ISIS after being recruited on the internet. A teenager who plotted to join ISIS and kill American soldiers has been sentenced to 5 years in prison. The 16-year-old planned to rob a gun store near Raleigh, North Carolina, and attack a U.S. military base before traveling to Syria to fight for ISIS. ISIS is gaining recruits and followers in other countries as well. Three schoolgirls from London have reportedly joined an all-female ISIS militia in Syria. In France, a 24-year-old technology student in Paris was captured this week after he accidentally shot himself. Authorities say he was planning to attack at least one church. A French prosecutor says Al-Qaeda and ISIS documents were found in the suspect's apartment. ISIS believes in establishing an Islamic state, a caliphate. And not only is it gaining recruits in the Middle East, but it's also bringing them in from around the world through its videos and internet marketing. And those recruits could join ISIS in Iraq and Syria. And they could also go back to their home countries and launch terrorist attacks, including right here in America.
While recent arrests show that officials are succeeding in their efforts to disrupt ISIS recruits, authorities don't see the lure of ISIS receding anytime soon.
Italian police are arresting suspected members of an Islamic terror ring. Members are accused of helping to execute attacks in Pakistan, including a market bombing that killed more than 100 people. Anti-terrorism police in Sardinia are in the process of executing 18 arrest warrants. Police say the terror network's goal was to create an insurrection against Pakistan's government.
Hillary Clinton is under fire once again over foreign donations to the Clinton Foundation. Now, an extensive New York Times investigation shows donations that give the appearance of Russian influence over U.S. policy when Hillary was Secretary of State. The report reveals millions of dollars from Russian interests flowed to the Clintons while her State Department was approving a deal for Russia to buy uranium mines inside the U.S. And the Clintons did not live up to their promise to disclose the donations to the Obama administration. Hillary Clinton is dismissing the reports as conspiracy theories.
President Obama is calling for a full review of the U.S. drone strikes that accidentally killed two hostages in Pakistan. The airstrike happened January 14th in a mountainous region. CIA officials say they monitored an Al-Qaeda compound for hundreds of hours and saw no signs of civilians there. But it was too late when they realized an American and an Italian aid worker were being held hostage in that same camp.
It is a cruel and bitter truth that in the fog of war generally, and our fight against terrorists specifically, mistakes, sometimes deadly mistakes can occur.
The drone strike also killed two other Americans, Adam Gadan and Ahmed Farfarouk, a dual U.S.-Pakistan national. They were both al-Qaeda operatives.
The Obama administration is working to repair relations with Israel and pro-Israel Democrats. The White House sent Vice President Joe Biden to a Washington celebration for Israel's independence. The vice president says America's desire to protect the Jewish state is personal. And President Obama is now trying to repair relations with American Jews and pro-Israel Democrats in Congress as he works to seal his nuclear deal with Iran.
Next week, the U.S. Supreme Court will hear cases likely to determine whether same-sex marriage will become legal right across the country. Some believe the justices have already decided to create that right before they actually hear the case. But as Paul Strand reports, others say it is far from decided.
Panel discussion at the Family Research Council was swimming upstream against conventional thought. That is, it's a foregone conclusion the Supreme Court justices will rule homosexuals have as much of a right to same-sex marriage as heterosexuals do to traditional marriage. But these panelists pointed out there's evidence that justices won't rubber stamp gay marriage.
When the lawyers walk into that courtroom on Tuesday morning, they're going to be walking into a situation where there are 3.5 justices who have said no constitutional right to same-sex marriage and no justices who have said there is a constitutional right.
One of the more interesting propositions brought up at this panel discussion is that maybe the Christians of the world owe it to the homosexuals to point out that their lifestyle is intrinsically wrong.
The faith actually teaches nothing about hatred toward gays and lesbians, in fact, the opposite. But it also says that the behavior is damaging and harmful to your eternal salvation. That's the faith teaching. But they also know from the empirical evidence that the behavior is damaging to your body as well.
Weston argued Christians need to say to gays,
we love you enough to tell you that this is harmful. In fact, we'll even take the hater and bigot label so that we can tell you this because we care about you.
The justices have rolled four cases together that will let them decide two questions. Must states recognize other states' gay marriages? And does the Constitution require states to allow same-sex marriage? Paul Strand, CBN News, Washington.
More Americans than ever before are delaying marriage. Research shows marriage used to be the cornerstone of adult life. It's now become the capstone. And Christian singles are finding that God has a purpose and a plan for this season in their lives.
These men and women gathered at New Life Providence Church in coastal Virginia have three things in common. They are Christian, over the age of 30, and they are all single.
Singleness is a big issue in our culture, and the church is a good place for us to talk about it. We need to talk about it because single people struggle just like married people.
CBN News anchor and author Wendy Griffith recently spoke to the group. She talked candidly about her journey as a single woman and the heartbreak that helped her figure out the kind of love God has in store for her.
One thing I learned that God showed me after the breakup was that I had loved him, but I had not loved myself. When you know your own value, you don't settle for bad behavior.
That lesson turned into a book, You Are a Prize to Be Won. God was able to use it to change Diane Urridge's life.
The book, I felt like it was what I had just gone through. And it really transitioned me onto a total different path of confidence and standing up for myself.
I just stand in amazement of God, how he can take the worst year of our life, our deepest pain, heartache, and turn it into a blessing to others.
That's exactly what God did for Melissa Dawn Simpkins. She's a successful entrepreneur living in Washington, D.C. And as you can see by the ring on her finger, she is not single. But she says her journey from singleness is something she hopes others can learn from.
I started dating like most single women, in my 20s, and fell in love with a gentleman that I thought was going to be my life partner and that I would marry. And suddenly, when I was 25, he died. He had was playing basketball and collapsed. And suddenly, I'm dealing with the question of, am I going to find love again? And if so, do I even want to live again?
She says after God healed her from her time of heartbreak and grief, her career as a brand strategist took off. She's worked with big-name clients like NBC All-Star Carmelo Anthony, singer Mary J. Blige, and the list goes on. Her love life was another story.
Before I looked up, it was, 10 years later, and I was still single, had a great career, but I was not married.
Then God told her this.
He showed me, this is who you've become, and allow me to help you move into who you really are.
Simpkins says God knows the big picture and your full potential. So when you wait on him, that's when he can work.
I'm at a party. I'm out socializing. I'm meeting and connecting with people. A guy stops me. He says, you should smile more often. And I'm thinking, I literally bought a shirt that said, make sure you smile because you never know who's going to fall in love with your smile, because it was reminding me I knew I needed to smile. I was like, I wasn't smiling. So I smiled and said, oh, thank you. And a gentleman was walking by behind the guy that said that to me. And he looked at me and he said, stop talking to him. Come talk to me.
Little did she know that man would become her husband. And her entire journey as a single woman would prompt her to create an organization called Women in the Spotlight. It helps women succeed without sacrificing their identity. Melissa believes her happy ending can happen for any single person desiring marriage.
My advice is to step up your faith. And when I say that is to expect God to do more.
When I saw your smile for the first time, my heart jumped.
I said, listen, this is a desire of my heart. And I believe that you put it in my heart. So I don't care if the statistics are not in my favor as an African-American female living in Atlanta. All I need is one. Make them, find them, do what you gotta do. But I just need one.
Like Melissa, Wendy is putting her faith into action and even dedicated her book to her future husband. She urges singles to not lose hope in the waiting.
God is saying, I've got something better for you. I've got my best for you. And so that's what I'm encouraging other women to not settle for crumbs.
And Wendy and I will be doing a live chat on social media about this story next Tuesday. You can share your story with us or ask questions. Just log on to CBN News' Facebook page for the details.
Coming up, big things happening for this big family. Hear the latest update from the Duggars and their joy in creating a godly heritage. It is another exciting year for the Duggar family. Season 9 of the TLC show, 19 Kids and Counting, is well underway. And it is a season full of lots of big news, including grandchildren, a half dozen, and another big wedding. Joining us with the latest are the patriarch and matriarch of the family, Jim Bob and Michelle Duggar. So good to have you both with us today. You've had some major life events over the last year. Now a new grandchild. What's it like to be grandparents once again?
It is the most wonderful thing to get to be grandparents. We've heard many people talk about how great it is. Well, now we know what they were talking about. It is so much fun. And we're just so excited. We're going from having 3 grandchildren to doubling the number of grandchildren this year to 6. We are so thankful, thrilled, and so excited. Yes.
Well, tell me this. How are Jill and Derek, as well as all your married children, coping with parenthood?
They're all doing very well. Derek is a great dad, a great husband, and Ben's a great husband, of course. And then Josh and Anna, of course, are expecting their 4th. And so it's pretty busy around the Duggar house.
Indeed.
Yes, and I think little Israel now is 2 weeks old. And so he's definitely not that little, though. He started out about 2 feet tall, and so we're just enjoying watching him grow even more now.
And moving so fast, I tell you. You've got some more grandparent news, this time about your newly married daughter, Jessa, correct?
Yes, yes. Jess and Ben just announced that they're expecting. And so this time last year, they were getting married about November. And this year, they will be having their first child, welcoming them into their home. So we don't know. We said, Jess, you never know. It could be twins. That kind of runs in our family, you know.
Indeed, it does. So what do your younger children think about all these weddings and the idea of being little uncles and aunts?
Yeah, for them, it's more like relatives and friends to play with.
So what makes you happiest when you think about your family and the godly heritage that you're establishing here?
Wow, I think the scripture that rings true in our hearts is that when we watch our children raising their children, we have no greater joy than to hear that our children walk in truth. And it is such a joy to watch Josh and Anna parenting their children and hearing them share some of those same Bible truths that we share with them years ago. And then now we're going to get to watch Derek and Jill and just look forward to Ben and Jess's little one arriving soon.
Beautiful. You know, we've all heard it said that God dreams bigger dreams for us than we do for ourselves. You guys, 19 kids and counting, how does this compare to the vision you had for your life and family?
Well, when we first started off, we thought we might have one or two or three children, and we share our testimony how God changed our heart about children on our website at duggarfamily.com. But we never dreamed we'd have this many. Mm-hmm. But we're so thankful for each one, and each one of our children are thankful to be here.
Wow. Our viewers, of course, big fans of the show. Any other surprises you can clue us in on?
I'm sure there was a lot of changes this past year in our family, and I think there's going to be a lot of exciting things coming up. Of course, Josiah just started a courtship relationship with Marjorie Jackson, who's a delightful young lady who loves the Lord. We went on a mission trip to El Salvador with her and her dad and her sister back in December, and so there's probably some more relationships brewing.
All right. Jim, Bob, and Michelle Duggar, thank you so much, and of course, we'll be watching. God bless you both and your family.
Up next, the Apple Watch is here. How new tech could mean new tech etiquette. We'll explain the do's and don'ts of Apple Watch wearing next.
Well, it is here, a big day for Apple lovers. The highly anticipated Apple Watch is now released, but with new tech can come new tech etiquette problems. Caleb Kinchlow explains and has more in the digital download.
The Apple Watch officially hit stores today. And although it's not the first smartwatch, the numbers say it is the most anticipated. There were nearly 1 million pre-sales. And unlike Apple's other devices, you never have to put it down, which means a whole new level of annoying tech habits. So I spoke with etiquette expert Joy Weaver to give us the do's and the don'ts of wearing a smartwatch.
The rules of etiquette are evergreen. They've always been and they always will be. So it's all about making other people feel special, putting others first, and that's what good manners are all about. But when technology came on the scene, it's all these different rules. And so we hear something buzzing, we hear something binging, we see something light up, and we think, oh, we have to take care of that first. And that is just not the case.
So when and where is it appropriate to use this kind of a device?
Just like the smartphone, any smartphone, you want to silence it, and especially in the worship center when you are at church, at funerals, and also, of course, at weddings. If you are on a date, especially a first date, if you're on a job interview, or any other place that you would silence your phone.
So if you're using a device, remember, always think people first and technology second. I'm Caleb Kinchlow, and this has been your Digital Download.
Ephraim?
Sorry. People first, right?
That's right.
You got it. Stay with us. There's more to come. We'll be right back.
A big movie about faith is hitting theaters this weekend. Here with more is Bob Waloszewski. He's with Focus on the Family's entertainment review department called Plugged In Online. Bob, the new movie Little Boy is getting tons of attention. Tell us about the story and how it ranks as a faith-friendly film.
Well, Mark Burnett and Roma Downey just hit another home run, not only with the AD series on the small screen, but as of today, Little Boy on the big screen. We gave it a 4.5 out of 5 for family friendliness. It's about a little boy who has all these great adventures with his dad. And when his dad is sent to World War II, the boy, with the help of a priest, is just believing that his dad is coming back. And so it's a powerful love story, if you will, between a father and his son.
Would you call this a faith-based film then?
Yeah, it's a great, great question. It's not a faith-based film in the same vein as a Fireproof or as a Courageous. It's more about having faith and the implication, because the boy spent some time with a priest, that the faith is about God. But this is not, I don't want anyone to mistake it for, there's probably an altar call coming. That doesn't negate that it's still a good film. This is just a great family-friendly film with a little bit of war violence that you might not want to take your younger kids to, but somewhere around the age of 9, 10, 11, there's something here this weekend that you can take the family to.
Okay. Well, switching gears, there's a new romance movie called The Age of Adeline. Could it make for a good date movie?
Well, it's questionable. We gave it a 3, which is neither that thumbs up nor the thumbs down. It's kind of that thumb sideways. So different couples are going to see it a little bit differently. The premise is very interesting to me. In 1935, this young lady, 29 years old, has a car wreck. And from that moment on, she never ages. Everyone around her, of course, ages. Her own daughter ages, but she stays at 29. She believes, we've seen some movies in the past dealing with immortality that see it as a blessing. This film takes a different take, and this is the part I like about it. Some great discussions could come about eternal life. This movie seems to see it as a curse. But the bigger disappointment for me, although never explicit, this young lady, we see several times, I'll just say, under the covers with different boyfriends in her history. And, of course, we find it a disappointment.
All right. Bob Waloszewski, as always, thank you so much for your time.
You bet.
Well, finally this hour, a message we call our Friday Faithful. This was on my heart as I literally got out of bed this morning. We so often hear young people today say the term YOLO, meaning you only live once, and it's usually an excuse to do something daring or to do something that is simply not right and less than what God expects. But know this, YOLO is wrong. We are living this life to live again, and it's best to live it right. That is what God is calling us to do, to be different than the rest of the world and to be the salt of the earth. So YOLO, no go.
And the church said,
Amen. Indeed. God.
Well, that's it for now on CBN NewsWatch. You can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com.
We'd love to hear what you think about the stories you've seen here today. You can do that on Facebook or at CBN News on Twitter. Hope you'll join us again right here next time. Make it a fabulous Friday, everybody.
YOLO, no.
YOLO, no go.